Okay, let's get started. Everyone has Bullet downloaded, compiled, installed, executed. Awesome. Okay. All right. Let's talk about assignment 5. So as I mentioned last time, and as you now know, at the end of assignment 4, you now have a clean, empty, fresh sheet of paper, so to speak, in the physics engine. You should have removed the ragdoll. And now through assignment 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10, we're going to be adding in 5 body parts, in 6 joints, in 7 motors, in 8 sensors, in 9 neural networks, and in the 10th one, the hill climber, which will evolve your neural networks on your simulated robot in the physics engine. Okay, so assignment 5 is a good time to sit down, take out a sheet of paper, and sketch out your robot and hold on to that piece of paper. Over the years, I've found sometimes old tech is often the best tech. And you're going to be sketching out your robot from different views so you can understand where everything sits in three-dimensional space. As I mentioned last week, one of the most common errors in the physics engine is placing invisible things like joints. So your body parts, your objects, your bodies and geoms, you should be able to actually see in the physics engines. In the physics engine, the joints you can't see, and if you put them in the wrong place, you get weird non-physical behavior and it's hard to debug it. Same for sensors and motors. So get used to drawing in 3D by drawing your quadruped, which is what we're going to be building in the next 5 assignments, so that you know exactly where the position of the center of the main body is, and the same goes for all the other parts. So just write it right on there, write your X, Y, and Z positions, the sizes of all the objects, and then next week you can add to that piece of paper the X, Y, and Z position of this joint, and at that position, the XYZ that defines the vector, which is the joint normal, and the joint normal dictates how the upper and lower body parts are going to rotate relative to one another. So you're going to start to annotate more and more this image, filling in positions, orientations, sizes, joint normals, where are the sensors, where are the motors, and so on. So do it in pencil. Okay. Yes?
I'm just curious, is that Z supposed to be a Y on the above front?
Let's see here. No, it's not, right? So this is the top view here. So if we look over here in the physics engine, X is going to be left and right, and Z is into the screen and towards you.
So each panel's different, sorry.
Exactly, and the Y component is vertical. So in the top view, you're going to be drawing the view of the robot as if you were looking down on it from above, which means you still have your x-axis, but now from this view, Z is pointed in this direction. So you're going to draw this little, this axis here and here, right? But they're going to be different. It's going to be a different pair for each of these views. Okay, so the screenshots that you're going to be submitting for assignment 5 should look like this. You have at the moment an empty physics engine. Add in just one of the 9 objects that makes up the robot and make sure that it ends up exactly where you expect it to be. Common mistake when you add the first object is you set the Y component, which is the vertical component, to 0, which means this object will actually be embedded in the floor, and when you run the physics engine, the object goes flying off into infinity. So we need to add a small amount of Y to make sure that the object is sitting just on the ground. Then increase the Y component like you increase the size of the bobbleheads in this week's assignment, and so on. And again, the idea here is to get you in the habit of making one small change to the physics engine at a time. If you coded up all 9 objects, positions and orientations and so on, and you ran it, even if there were no bugs, you might get the objects all over the place. You'll have no idea whether this is object 3 or this is object 3. Is everything in the right place? So make sure you add one object and it's in the right place and it has the right size. then add the next object, make sure it's at the right position and has the right size, and so on and so forth, right? Get in the habit of visually inspecting your physics engine when it starts up. And if you thought you added the upper leg to the left side of the main body, make sure that it is actually on the left side of the body. Okay, after assignment 5, you should be very familiar with where is positive x and negative x, positive z, negative z, and negative y and positive y. Okay, pretty straightforward, but it'll get you sort of into the physics engine code a little bit. Any questions about assignment 5? That reminds me, last Thursday's quiz, I made an error in some of the questions. Some of you emailed me about it. I told you that the ragdoll is made up of 10 parts and 9 non-motorized joints. That's not true, right? There's 11 body parts and 10 non-motorized joints. So if you got dinged on the quiz, I'll have the TA go back and retroactively fix solutions to some of those questions. My apologies on that one. Okay. So back to the schedule for a moment. We are going to finish our discussion of the first years of evolutionary robotics today. We were talking last time about some work done, some of the first experiments done by Italian researchers using this very small Kepler robot. We'll finish that discussion. We'll talk about the second experiment that was done at the same time in England, and that will conclude our discussion of the history of evolutionary robotics, and then we'll come back and talk about Lecture 8 when we get there. Okay, so again, just to refresh your memory, we were talking about this little small hockey puck type robot, the Kepra. You can attach modules on top. We talked about the setup they created. They were evolving this little Kepra to drive around on a tabletop. The robot was connected to a computer. The computer was doing the evolution and would send commands to the robot. The robot would move, and there would be sensation coming back, and around we go. We saw that we could actually, they evolved controllers for this Kepra to drive around the maze as much as possible. We saw last time that the researchers fixed some aspects of the neural network and allowed the other aspects of the neural network to be evolved. The researchers fixed which of the synapses were excitatory and which were inhibitory, and they did it in such a way to favor the Breitenberg-type behaviors that we saw, which were to turn away from obstacles on your opposite side, right? Okay, so they fixed the synapses to be excitatory, positive values, or inhibitory, negative values, but evolution was then free to evolve the magnitudes of those weights, more or less negative, or more or less positive. We talked about the fitness function. We saw that they successfully evolved behavior. And I think we ended here last time. And I left you with a question, which was, they knew that the top speed of the robot was 80 millimeters per second, but it never evolved to drive that fast. And it wasn't just that evolution sort of ran out of time. They were pretty sure that it could have evolved, or it could go faster, but it never evolved to do so. Why might that be the case?
Perhaps the faster ones kept running into the walls.
Could be, right? So maybe if there were evolutionary changes to the synaptic weights, it would drive faster and then slam into the walls, but maybe it could also evolve to avoid the walls at the higher speed. Wasn't that problem directly?
It didn't need to go faster?
There was definitely, remember in the fitness function, there's V in there, right? Go as fast as possible, uppercase V. So there's selection pressure. Evolution is selecting for things that go faster. Any hardware engineers here? So remember, this is the mid-1990s. So the sensors on board the robot, they would refresh every 3/10 of a second, somewhere around there. So the sensors were being pulled or refreshed 3/10 of a second. That's the reason, but why would that be the reason? It would be outrunning its sensors, exactly. So it could, it, sometimes it just couldn't avoid the walls because it was going so fast that the sensors couldn't respond in time. So the top speed that it actually did reach, 48 millimeters per second, was the fastest it could go and still detect a wall in time to turn away from it, right? Kind of interesting. Evolution found that there's a fundamental constraint for this robot, which is the refresh rate of the robot. And evolution found that point. It didn't go beyond it. Okay. Sometimes the robot would evolve to drive forward, and sometimes it also evolved to drive backwards through the maze. But mostly, whenever they did this, it was mostly forward. Not very often did it evolve to go backwards. Why? The fitness function just said, drive around the maze. I don't care whether you do it forward or backwards.
So they fixed the rate very quickly. So specific synapses were inventory and others are exemplary, so that would kind of force it to more so go forward.
That's true. So you can see a mixture of excitatory and inhibitory connections here. And now that I look at it, you can see that these are all excitatory here. I don't know if that's a typo. I think these should be inhibitory, actually. But there is a Breitenberg there connected to the back sensors.
There's more sensors in the front?
There's more sensors in the front, right? So if you're going to have to try and avoid obstacles, it just has more sensation at the front. It has a richer sensorium, better to go forward than backward. But again, there was nothing explicitly in the fitness function that said go forward. Okay. All right, let's jump across the English Channel now to the University of Sussex in southern England. In 1994, there was this very interesting robot reported in the literature. This is the Sussex gantry robot, and I'll walk you through this cartoon here. It's just kind of an interesting robot. So they had an empty or a cutout table that was sitting on top of arbitrary scenes that they could make under the table. And sitting on top of the table was this gantry robot. And this gantry robot had two motors, one which would drive this larger trolley along the x-axis back and forth. And then on top of this large gantry, on top of this large trolley was a smaller trolley that would drive back and forth along the y dimension on top of the trolley that was going through x and y. So they could move, or the robot could move this trolley arbitrarily to any position in the table. And then there was a third motor, which was attached to a rotating dental mirror, which is kind of hard to see in this picture here. And there's a downward-facing camera here. So this is almost like an inverted periscope. So the camera is pointing down to a camera that's tilted at 45 degrees, which means the camera can see around this periscope, if you like. And the third motor could rotate this mirror. An exceedingly odd robot, to say the least. Why build a robot like this? As you can imagine, they're now going to evolve these three motors or this robot to do something. Why build the robot in this way? Sorry?
Filming movies.
It could film movies, or at least that was difficult to do back in the mid-90s, but they were able to capture through the camera this particular view that was afforded by this camera. But what was this view?
Well, the view is inside of the scene, but it might be to try to evolve how to do it, because thinking about the actual motors involved might be not an easy solution for a bunch of people sitting at their desk.
Absolutely, right? So you can see this periscope facing down here. They could put objects in the scene. If you had a robot that was driving around among these objects, the cable is going to get snared, right? There's problems about doing this. So this robot is relatively free to drive around inside the scene under the table. And what happens when the third motor rotates this mirror that's tilted at 45 degrees? How does its view change? It rotates and it's sort of seeing around itself inside the scene. So we have a robot that can, quote unquote, drive around inside the scene and can, quote, can look around, quote unquote, inside the scene, right? It can look left or look right. And by rotating the camera 360 degrees, it can look all around itself.
What is that mirror rotating? Is it vision invert?
This takes a little bit of thinking about. So the camera is pointing down, okay? And it's pointing down and it's pointing at the mirror, which is rotated at 45 degrees. And the motor is in here, so it's tilting the motor, it's tilting the mirror around like this.
Yeah.
So it's not inverted, the inversion doesn't change as the mirror rotates. The picture might be upside down, but from the point of view of the robot.
Well, wouldn't the picture be upside down for 180, and the other 180 would be like that up?
No, because it's continuously rotating, right? This mirror can rotate around 360 degrees. So the view does not distort or invert as it rotates. Okay. The other nice thing about this is if you look at it, is obviously it's connected by a tether to the computer. So if they download a neural network and that neural network controls the gantry robot, controls these three motors, the periscope moves around and the mirror rotates, and then when the robot is done, they can send commands that will reset the gantry robot to the same initial conditions, execute the next neural network and the next one and the next one and so on, right? So the goal was to try and make this process automatic, was to make this process as automatic as possible. Again, mid-90s technology, it wasn't perfectly automatic, but they could sort of execute a bunch of neural networks one after the other without any human intervention, without having to go in and change batteries, without having to go in and unsnarl cables, and so on. So kind of a Rube Goldberg setup here, kind of an odd-looking robot, but there's method to the madness here. Okay, so I told you just a little bit about the three motors, right? We also need to define the sensors. So this robot has 7 sensors, and again, the sensors are also kind of odd in this case. The robot has a little disc down here, and if the periscope bumps into any obstacles under the table, that disc will rotate, and depending on the angle at which the disc rotates, when it hits something, they can detect whether the robot was bumped from the front right, back left, or front left. So they have a little disc, and they use the information that's coming from the disc to set 1 of 4 touch sensors, if you like. Was I bumped in either of my 4 quadrants or not? Okay, so 4 tactile sensors, if you like. The interesting sensors here, however, are the visual sensors. So as the robot is moving around, it's receiving frames from the downward pointing camera that provide a view around the robot horizontally. So let's take our raw camera image here. So N is to the north of the robot, west of the robot, south of the robot, east of the robot. It's rotated a little bit. They do a little bit of manipulation to the image, but it's basically the same image. Then they drop 3 receptive fields into this picture that's been captured from the camera. And the position and the size of these visual fields is dictated by the underlying genotype. So this is something we haven't seen before. What we've seen so far is that the genotype, the string of numbers, usually represents the weights of the synapses in the neural network. Up to this point, the only thing that evolution has been doing is tinkering with the neural network or the brain of the robot. In this experiment now, they're expanding or broadening the reach of evolution. Now it's not just tinkering with the neural network, it's also tinkering with the sensors, how the robot sees the world. Okay. So how does this work? Well, if you think about this, we have 3 receptive fields, and that's represented by the 3 colored, the shaded circles that you see inside the image. For each one of these circles, we need 3 numbers, x, y, and the radius. So x and y, where is the receptive field sitting inside the camera image? And the radius is, what is the radius of that circle? And evolution is dictating the sizes of those circles. Once the robot starts moving at every time step, whenever a frame is captured from the camera, an algorithm takes all of the pixels inside each of those three receptive fields and calculates the average intensity or the average grayscale of the pixels inside that receptive field. So how light or how dark on average is it inside that receptive field? So far, so good? Okay, so we have 7 sensors. We have 3 motors. What is the robot actually going to do? So let's talk about the fitness function for a moment. They did various things with the gantry robot, but today we're just going to talk about a relatively simple experiment in which there were no obstacles under the table, but they placed a back wall under the table, and they could paint various scenes onto that wall. And they started with simple scenes and moved up to slightly more complicated scenes. And they did this to try and make things easier on evolution, so they used an approach variously known as incremental evolution or scaffolding. And we're going to see many examples of this idea as we go through the course. So the idea is kind of intuitive, right? Start with a simple fitness function that selects for a simple behavior. Once a successful robot evolves, make the fitness function a little bit more complicated, and then continue evolution from wherever you left off. Once evolution succeeds at that more complex fitness function, pause evolution for a moment, add some terms or change the fitness function a little bit, and then continue evolution. Okay, so the first fitness function here, phi 1, is simply when the robot starts from 4 different initial conditions. So in everything we're going to see here, each neural network in the population that was being evolved is evaluated 4 times. We take a neural network, we move the gantry robot to one position under the table, allow that neural network to do its thing, calculate fitness, move the gantry robot to another initial position, take the same neural network, allow it to do its thing, record fitness. So we get 4 fitness values back. And then we average them. On average, how well did this particular neural network do under these 4 different conditions? Okay, first fitness function, not that hard. Wherever you are and however the camera is rotated or however the mirror is rotated, drive towards the back wall, which is just a big black rectangle. Once you do that, now we're going to change the picture at the back. So now you need to approach a back rectangle, which covers just part of the back wall under the table. And then finally, whenever we turn on the neural network, there's going to be a triangle on the left and a rectangle on the right, or a rectangle on the left and a triangle on the right. And we're going to evolve robots that avoid rectangles and approach triangles. If you have the x and y coordinates of this periscope at every point in time, what might you write down for phi 1? What's a fitness function that will select for moving towards the back wall?
Distance from the back wall.
Distance from the back wall, not too hard, right? Distance from the rectangle, distance from the triangle minus the distance from the rectangle. So minimize distance to the triangle and maximize distance from the rectangle. Don't go to the rectangle and then go to the triangle. Rectangles are dangerous. Avoid them. Okay, so here we go. Here's our little summation here. So I equals 1 to 4. The summation here is showing us that we're summing up the fitness components over 4 trials on the same neural network. So this is something that often gets confusing whenever we talk about an evolutionary robotics experiment. Remember that we have a population of neural networks, and we want to compute the fitness for each one in the population. Each one of them, we might evaluate multiple times in different environments. Okay, so perpendicular distance from the opposite wall, distance of the robot from the center of the rectangle, minimized here, and then finally minimize the distance to the triangle and maximize your distance from the rectangle. What do these alpha and beta parameters do in the fitness function? What would happen if we set alpha to 1 and beta to 0? What kind of behavior would that select for? So what is uppercase D1I selecting representing? So D1, distance of the rectangle from the start point. So wherever we place the rectangle, we're taking that, the distance from the initial condition of the robot to the rectangle, minus lowercase d1i, which is the final distance of the robot from the rectangle. So uppercase d1i is the distance of the robot at time step 0 from the rectangle. The robot moves, stops moving. We now have the current distance of the periscope or the robot from the rectangle. Uppercase d minus lowercase d. What does that represent now? The distance traveled, or how much closer or how much further from the rectangle it got. Right. Okay. What about this term over here? Or sorry, let's go back to the original question. So if we set alpha to 1 and beta to 0, we're just selecting for this term. What are we going to get? We're trying to maximize this, right?
Cameras that move around a lot.
Sorry?
Cameras that move around a lot.
They're going to move away from their initial position. But in which way?
Maybe disregard the triangle.
So the triangle is dropping out because we've set beta to 0. So how does the robot respond to the rectangle?
They're just going as far away as possible.
As far away as possible. That's right. So actually that would mean that this is bigger than this, which would be a negative number.
Yeah.
So I guess we're trying to minimize things here. This is always confusing. Are we trying to minimize the fitness function or maximizing it? If we work this out, I guess we're trying to minimize it here, right? We're trying to make this term as negative as possible. Right? Okay. If we set alpha to 0 and beta to 1, so our fitness function becomes minus uppercase D2 minus lowercase D2. What would we select for in that case? If we just had that term. How close you can get to the triangle, right? So if we set both of these to about the same weights, then we're selecting equally for approach the triangle and move away from the rectangle. If we make one of these larger or smaller than the other, we can differentially weight how much we want the robot to approach or avoid these separate objects. Okay. Here's a picture, here's a representation of an evolved neural network that successfully does this task. If we put the triangle on the left and start from 1, 2, 3, 4 initial conditions, the robot, again, doesn't know its own position, right? It doesn't have that as an input to the neural network. All it has are the 4 bump pieces of information and the average intensity or light levels in the receptive fields. Despite the fact that it doesn't know where it is, we can see that it hones in on the triangle. If we put the triangle on the right and the rectangle on the left, the same neural network from these same initial conditions would go to the right rather than the left. So this is a picture from overhead to show us that the robot is generally doing what we evolved it to do. Now comes the fun part. How does it actually do it? So in this case, we have the sensors lined up on the left here and the motors lined up on the right here. And you'll notice something interesting. Remember, I told you that we have 7 sensors. In this case, the robot only the neural network only chose to use 2 of the 7 sensors. It's using V1 and V2. So it's using 2 receptive fields. And this is where evolution has placed those 2 receptive fields and their size. So remember that in this case, evolution is evolving the size and position of these receptive fields in addition to the weights of connections from the sensors to, in this case, they included hidden neurons. Remember in our discussion of artificial neural networks, hidden neurons are hidden from the real world. They receive signals from the outside world via the sensor neurons. They do their thing and pass on their signals to the 3 motors. Why does this neural network work?
Makes circles, makes loops. Is that because the camera is rotating and it can't see 360 degrees at once?
Actually, so the loops that you can see here, this is the trajectory of motion of the robot. So it's not really doing loops. It's the 2 trolleys driving relative to one another, which causes the position of the periscope to be at these positions over time. The little lines that you can see here, these are showing what the orientation of the camera was when the periscope was there. So the dot represents the position of the periscope, and the short line connected to the dot shows the orientation, which direction the mirror was pointing. What was it looking at? That makes sense? Okay, so how does this neural network work? The dotted lines represent inhibitory connections. The solid lines represent excitatory connections. You see that most of the lines are flowing from the sensors to the hidden neurons, some directly onto the motors. More or less, all of the synapses are flowing from sensors to motors. But some of them are coming back again. We have these recurrent connections. Here's a self connection. What do recurrent connections do? Remember our discussion about artificial neural networks. So if a neural network does not have recurrent connections, what can it not do? What general function do recurrent connections give to a neural network?
Remembering,
right? So when we're updating these neural networks now, these neurons, the value of this neuron, let's pick another one here. The value of this neuron here is a sum of this times this plus this times this, the previous value of this. So it's able to retain information from previous time steps. You can see that there's quite a few of these recurrent connections, which is a hint about what the strategy that the neural network is using to solve this task.
This is only a little related, but have we made ANDs that can make new neurons and new synapses?
Yes, and we're going to talk about that later in the course. So at the moment, we have a fixed architecture, right? How many neurons there are and which connections are available, and evolution can decide which to use. We're going to look at evolutionary algorithms that add, remove, and modify neurons and synapses. In this case, not. Okay. So this neural network is remembering things. It's evolved to remember things. But there is no detect triangle module in this neural network. There's no detect rectangle. So how is it able to discriminate between, how can it discriminate between triangles and rectangles if there aren't these functions inside this neural network? Here's hint number 2. Look at where these 2 receptive fields are placed. They're not lined up vertically, they're not lined up horizontally, they're lined up at an angle.
So if it's getting, if it's seeing black in both the 1 and 2, it would know it's a rectangle.
So if it's seeing black in, let's take 1 time instant. And at that time instant, both of these receptive fields on average are black. Is it looking at a rectangle or a triangle?
Don't necessarily know.
You don't necessarily know, right? It's not sufficient information. You could be looking at the inside of a triangle or the inside of a rectangle. But we're getting closer. So what else does it need to do?
Is it determining the size based off of how big their field of view is?
The size here doesn't matter too much. You can see that these two receptive fields are a little bit smaller or bigger. That ended up not being that important in this case.
It can detect the diagonal boundary line.
Okay. How does it detect the diagonal boundary line?
So if part of one of the field is dark and the other part is light, and then the same with the other one, part is dark and then the other part is light, then that sort of tells you it's a diagonal boundary line.
That's exactly it, right? So as the robot is moving, the average darkness in these two receptive fields is changing, and at a certain point in time, one of them may go dark before the other. Now, depending on the size and the noise, they may darken at not quite the same time instant, even when it's hitting the edge of the rectangle. So what discriminates for this robot between triangles and rectangles is the time that elapses between this one going dark and then this one going dark. If this one goes dark just a little bit before or at about the same time as this one, it's just hit the edge of a triangle. If a rectangle is approaching, or it is turning towards a rectangle, one is going to go dark, and then two will go dark later than when it hits the edge of a triangle. This, to me, is the best example of embodied cognition and how evolution exploits the body and motion of the robot. Right? Remember our discussion about embodied cognition. If we have a robot that just, or an AI program that just sits there and passively gets information from the world, it's at a disadvantage compared to a robot or an animal or a human that moves around and pushes against the world. In this case, there's no obstacles here. The robot isn't literally pushing against anything. But by acting in the world, it's generating sensor data, and based on the sensor data it gets back as a result of its motion, it can distinguish between different objects. Okay? This is an extremely non-intuitive solution to discriminating between triangles and rectangles. Right? If I gave you the gantry robot and said, write some Python code to transform sensor signals into motors, you'd probably write a recognized triangle function and a recognized rectangle function. No such thing here. It just emerges from the way the robot moves around and the sensory data that results. That's what the recurrent connections are for, right? If it's about relative timing, what's the time span between one and two going dark, it needs to remember when one went dark. Okay. Extremely non-intuitive, but a pretty simple circuit, actually. It only requires two numbers, right? The darkness of this one and the darkness of this one. It's throwing all the other pixels away, right? Using a very small piece of the visual field. Evolution is lazy. It'll come up with the simplest solution that relies on the least amount of information. And whether evolution's solution, lazy solution, is interpretable to us or not, well, that's our problem. Okay. Luckily, in this case, it's simple enough that we can understand it.
Dan? Once it sees an edge, does it just remember where that edge is, or does it keep looking?
That's where our understanding of this network breaks down. What does it actually do at that point? The story that I told you is sort of an approximation of what it's really doing. So it's not a matter of, does it then remember and then just sort of do its thing? It's a continuous thing over time, right? The robot is continuously moving. The values in here are continuously changing. But we can sort of approximate a description of what it's doing in that way. Right? This is the cost that we pay for automating the generation of adaptive behavior. We give up being able to interpret perfectly what the robot's doing. Okay. But the point here, again, given a thing that can move around the environment and generate its own sensory stimulation, can be exploited by evolution to come up with a simple solution that's relatively robust. Right? Imagine we kept going and we said, all right, avoid triangles that have a particular slope and go towards triangles with a sharper slope. It would be tinkering with this solution to now look at relative timings, even finer relative timings, right? It's a pretty good, robust solution that can be repurposed for different shapes and so on. Okay. All right, that concludes lecture 7. Let's jump back to the schedule for a moment. So we've talked about the first two experiments that were done with physical robots and highlight a lot of the advantages of the evolutionary approach to robotics. We're going to move on now to another set of experiments which collectively have become known as the minimal cognition experiments. And they're called minimal cognition experiments because for most people, we're not just interested in locomotion and object manipulation and distinguishing triangles from rectangles. These are pretty simple things. We want to try and evolve a robot that is cognitive, that it's performing intelligent tasks, more complicated things than just locomotion and object manipulation and discrimination. We want to evolve a robot that if you showed it to a cognitive scientist and that cognitive scientist did not know how this robot was evolved, they didn't get to see the neural network that you just saw, the cognitive scientist might point at that robot and say, yes, it's exhibiting cognitive ability X, Y, or Z. So we'll look at some robots that seem to exhibit the building blocks of cognition. And in order to do this, we're going to try and simplify our robots even further to make things as simple as possible to really see whether we're on the road to evolving more and more complex and ultimately cognitive behaviors. Okay. The robots we're going to see in lecture 9 are equipped with a particular kind of neural network, which unfortunately is not minimal. These particular kinds of neural networks are more complicated than the ones that we've seen before. These are CTRNNs. It's a bit of a mouthful here. Continuous time recurrent neural networks. So we've already seen recurrence, these self connections or connections that are flowing back from the motor layer to the sensor layer. What we haven't seen yet are continuous time neural networks. And we're going to talk about CTRNNs first, then we'll talk about minimally cognitive agents in lecture 9. Okay, so lecture 8, I realize it's only 9 in the morning. We're going to do a little bit of calculus, but we're not going to do too much just to refresh your memory, right? This one should be pretty straightforward. Slope is defined as the change in y divided by the change in x. Calculus arose out of the problem of what happens when you want to say what the slope is as this line becomes shorter and shorter and shorter, right? As this delta x becomes smaller and this delta y becomes smaller, slope is undefined when delta x reaches zero. Okay, so that was the invention of the calculus. We can do difference equations, which is actually what you were doing in assignment 3. The new value of neuron x is equal to the old value of neuron x in some function of that. Right? So here's the problem written as a difference equation. So it's easy to write down how a variable changes over relatively large time steps. But as those time steps become smaller and smaller and smaller, things get tricky. So we're going to set aside in CTRNNs using difference equations to update our neurons, and we're going to switch to using differential equations to represent how neuron values change over time. So again, if I write down dx over dt equals 1, we have a differential equation, and this basically just says that the rate of change in x is equal to the rate of change in t, right? Same thing. For the sake of brevity from now on, I'm just going to use x prime to represent dx over dt. Okay, everybody remember their very basic calculus? All right. Okay, so here we go. You're going to be filling in a differential equation here to describe how neurons and CTRNNs change. I've left white space here because we're going to keep adding things as we go. So if you're taking notes here, make sure to try and leave the same space that you see inside my red box here. It'll help you annotate it. So at the end, we're going to have a relatively complicated differential equation. So we're going to build up this differential equation piece by piece. So again, just to refresh our memory, if we had a difference equation to update our neuron 1, the new value of neuron 1 at time step t plus 1 is a function of, here's our activation function, the old value of neuron 1 multiplied by the weight of the synapse that connects neuron 1 to neuron 1, that's the self-connection, plus the value of neuron 2 multiplied by the weight of the connection that connects neuron 2 to neuron 1, and so on. So the equation in assignment 3 that you saw was a difference equation, and it represented how the value of neuron 1 changed over time. All right. Going to go from x to y here. So y sub I is going to be the value of neuron I at a given time. So the left-hand side here, we've got yi prime. So the rate of change of the value of neuron I is equal to the negative of the current value of neuron I. This is kind of an odd thing to see. So let's try and do this geometrically to get a feel for how this works. So I'm going to put time, or t, on the horizontal axis here, and y on the vertical axis here. This is 0, 0. So positive values indicate that neuron yi is excited. It has a positive value. And negative values of y sub I indicate that the neuron is inhibited. It has a negative value.
Wouldn't that mean that at every next time step, we just reset? So you go from y to 0, and then the rate of change of negative 0 is
okay.
0,
so we need to put on our calculus hats, right? You're close, but remember that there's instantaneous change here.
Oh.
So let's actually start with a few simple examples. Let's imagine that I start with y sub I, and in brackets here, I'm going to put the value of t. So at t equals 0, the value of y sub I is equal to 0. So when we start the neural network, let's set all the neurons equal to 0. How does this value change continuously over time? The rate of change of this is equal to? 0, right? So we plug in the current value of y on the right-hand side, minus 0 is 0. The rate of change of neuron I is 0. So its value doesn't change. That's what it looks like. Okay, let's try another example. Let's try let's set the initial value of y sub I at t0 equal to 1. Now what happens? Sorry?
The next time step goes down to 0.
It doesn't go all the way to 0, right? There is no next time step. This is a continuous time.
Okay.
This is a continuous time neural network.
It approaches
0, right? Okay, now you've got your calculus hat on.
Okay.
Good. Okay.
Like,
so the rate of change of y sub I is equal to negative 1, right? The slope is negative 1 at t0, so it starts to drop continuously. And it approaches 0. Does it ever reach 0? Right? Again, with our calculus hats on, it will asymptotically approach 0, but never actually reach it. If we started with an initial value of 1, what if we start with an initial value of minus 1? The same decay, but in which direction? Inversely, right? So we plug negative 1 into the right-hand side. Negative negative 1 is plus 1. So the instantaneous rate of change of y sub I at t0 is positive, right? The slope is 1. So up it goes, and we get the same decay, and it asymptotically approaches 0 from below.
Is this like refraction?
This is like the refraction, which is an idea from neural science. So actually, each of the terms that we're going to add to this differential equation are based on mechanisms observed in biological nervous systems. Refraction is the idea that, assuming that a neuron is not stimulated, So this neuron is not connected to by any other neurons. It will gradually come to rest or refract back to some base level, which in this equation so far is zero. What happens if I set the initial conditions of y sub I to any value in the interval between minus 1 and plus 1?
Just change how slowly it approaches.
It just changes how slowly, right? So all of these will approach zero eventually, right? There's no incoming stimulation to the neuron. I set it to initial value, and it decays or refracts down to zero. Okay, not a very interesting neural network. So let's add in a little bit of detail now. This is something that we haven't seen before. And this particular addition to our neural network, these time constants, are going to become very important. And they're one of the distinguishing features of ctRNNs compared to the simpler ANNs you've been creating so far. So we've got tau sub I now. I've written it on the left-hand side, which some of you might not have seen before, right? Usually most of the complexity lies on the right-hand side. We just write this as y sub I prime equals. So mentally, you can move the tau to the other side. What this really represents is y prime equals minus y divided by tau. But just so we can write everything as one line rather than a fraction, I'm putting the tau over here. Okay? All right. So the time constant is, as you can imagine, is going to alter the timing of the neuron. And let's see if I can grab an eraser here. Okay. So let's assume for the moment, let's keep things simple by assuming that time constants are always going to be positive, zero or above. And let's go back to our simpler example of y sub I 0 equals 1. Let's imagine that tau sub I is a huge number. Million, billion, trillion, doesn't matter. How is the value of y sub I going to change continuously over time for a very, very large value of tau?
If we have y prime equals minus y over tau, that would barely change at all.
It would barely change at all, right? So we're dividing 1 by a very, very large value. So we have something that's very close to 0, minus 1 divided by a very large number. It's still negative, but very, very small. So we get something that approaches 0 much more slowly. Yes? Okay, let's say we have y sub I, so this is for tau, a tau that is very large, tau, much larger than zero. What about a tau that's very close to zero? So let's start with an initial value of 1 for our neuron again, and a value that's very close to zero. How is the value of neuron I going to change over time now?
Really quickly.
Really quickly, right? So we're dealing with the continuous case. If we actually implement this in a computer, it depends how we do it and how we integrate these differential equations over time. If we do it as an approximation, we might actually overshoot and do something like this, but we're not going to worry about this case for the moment. We're just trying to build up an intuition for how this thing works. So we can either approach very slowly or we can approach very quickly. So I remember this by thinking of tau approaching zero as the Woody Allen neurons. Any slight perturbation, they go completely crazy. They're very sensitive. They'll jump all over the place. If you have a tau that's very, very large, it's very sanguine, right? It's kind of always doing its thing. It'll alter a very little bit and very slowly, but that's about it. So the time constants, what they do by setting different time constants changes the rate of reaction of the neuron over time. How quickly or slowly does it change its value? Okay. However, we still don't have anything actually influencing y sub I, so it's either going to approach zero faster or slowly depending on our time constant. So far, so good? All right, let's add in a little bit more detail. This part you've already seen, right? So now we're assuming we don't just have one neuron, but we have 10 or 100 or 1,000, where Y sub I now references the ith neuron in a neural network made up of many neurons. So if we have a neural network made up of 10 neurons, we actually have 10 differential equations. And this is the representative one. If we have 100 neurons in our neural network, we have a set of 100 differential equations. Okay, so we're going to influence the rate of change of Y sub I based on all of the ways in which I is being influenced by every other of the N neurons in the population, right? The new rate of change of Y sub I is a function of the current value of another neuron, J, multiplied by the weight that connects neuron J to neuron I. Let's imagine that all of these values are positive and all of these weights are positive. So this entire term is positive. All of the other neurons are trying to excite neuron I. How does neuron I change continuously over time? Let's imagine again that we start with an initial value of 1.
It fully depends on the value of I, the value of Y, and the value of the combined neurons.
Absolutely. So the specifics depend, but let's just kind of think in big terms here, right?
Well,
what's happening?
It takes the Y's value, then it'll just keep going up.
Exactly, right? So if the total influence of all the other neurons is more excitatory, this overall value is more positive than the tendency of this to go towards zero. So with an initial value of 1, this is minus 1. If this sum is greater than 1, this will actually start to increase, right? So there are two competing values here. But the moment that it increases at some time in the future, now y sub I is greater than 1, what happens to its value now, given our differential equation so far? It drops faster, right? So this term is increasing, right? So there's a tug of war now between the excitation coming from all the other neurons and this neuron's lazy tendency to try and refract back to zero. But of course, this neuron is also influencing the other neurons based on it, the synaptic weights that connect it to the other neurons. So we're back to this complex interplay now. And if we were to plot how these neurons change over time, we wouldn't have a discrete checkerboard pattern like you had in assignment 3. We would have neuron 1, Y sub 1, Y sub 1 doing something like this, and Y sub 2 doing something like this, and Y sub 3 doing something like this, and so on, right? We would get continuous dynamics over time, and the dynamics of each individual neuron might be different, like you saw before. Also, like you saw before, you get feedback loops. When one goes up, it more strongly inhibits another one, which goes down, and that one stops exciting the other one, and it drops, and you get these feedback loops, and you get very rich behavior. The rate at which something changes is based on its own time constant. So when you're thinking about studying this equation, pay attention to all the subscripts, right? This is not tau, this is tau sub I. What is tau sub I telling you about the system?
Time constant at that particular time step.
It's not at that time step, right? There's no actual reference to t
that
here.
Neuron, sorry.
That neuron, right? Remember, sub I means we're talking about the rate of change of the ith neuron. So each neuron has its own time constant. So in a single artificial neural network, you might have one neuron that's very sanguine and isn't influenced very much by all the other neurons. Some of the other neurons might be your Woody Allen neurons, and they're going crazy. They're all over the place. But even though they're connected strongly to another one, they're not influencing it, or it takes them longer to deflect the change trajectory for that neuron.
Do you call them Woody Allen neurons because the tau is small and he's like a very short dude?
I call them Woody Allen neurons because any perturbation to a neuron that has a low time constant, it will immediately change what it's doing, right? It's now off here. Oh my gosh, I forgot I need to go low or high. Go watch a Woody Allen movie and you'll know what I'm talking about, right? Any slight input to the system and it's all over the place. Okay, so we have more or less sensitive neurons depending on their time constant. Okay. Let's add in a little bit more detail. This is a little bit odd. We haven't seen this before. Here's the activation function, which you have seen before. In continuous time neural networks, we tend to use the tanh function, which will squash things down to a value between minus 1 and plus 1, which you've seen before. When you've seen this before, usually the activation function was outside the summation. Now it's inside the summation. So what that means is that when neuron J is influencing neuron I, whatever the raw value of J is, it may be larger than 1, or it may be more negative than minus 1, it may have a very large and negative value, but it's going to be squashed. The value of J is going to be squashed to a value between minus 1 and plus 1. After it's been squashed, it's multiplied by its synaptic weight and added to this and so on. So if at any point in time we actually look at the raw value of a neuron, it may be larger than 1 or less than minus 1, but whenever it's influencing another neuron, it's between plus 1 and minus 1. Okay. So what we're going to do is whenever we actually use a CTRNN to control a robot, whenever we have a motor neuron, remember the motor neuron is outputting a value to control a wheel or a limb or a joint or what have you, we're going to not send the value of Y sub I to a motor. We're going to send the squashed value of Y sub I to the motor. So we're always taking this value here and sending it to the motors, not the raw value, because we don't know what the range of the raw value might be. It's a little detail, but again, just to help you build up an intuition for what these things are, that's why we've got the activation function inside there. Okay, more detail. Let's add in a gain for each neuron in the population. So again, to keep things simple, let's just imagine a gain is a positive value, 0 and upward. And you'll notice that there's a G sub J here. What is the subscript telling you in this case?
The gain of the
jth neuron, exactly as it says right there, right? There isn't some one gain for all the neurons. Each value has its own gain, and some of those neurons might have more or less gain. Why add in this yet additional detail to the neural network? Let's imagine that there is one neuron in the population, let's say y sub 2 here, and y sub 2 has a gain of 0. G sub 2 equal to 0. What happens in that case?
So any value that it lets loose is going to be 0. So like it doesn't really matter what the value of the neuron is. It's always going to emit a 0.
Exactly.
So if you had some really big gain, every time it would always activate. So if you had like a stop neuron that you really needed everything to listen to, you'd put the gain to be like 500, I don't know.
Exactly. So you'd put the gain, or evolution would put the gain,
yeah,
to be a very large value, right? So in essence, we're going to put all of these things under evolutionary control. So far you've seen neural networks where we've evolved the weights. In CTRNNs, we're evolving not just the weights, but also all the taus and all the Gs. So if evolution reduces one neuron's G towards 0, evolution is, in essence, silencing that neuron. You think back to the gantry robot that we just saw. It had 7 sensor neurons, but it only used 2 of them. In essence, evolution silenced the other ones. It says, I don't need this neuron. I don't care what it does. When I compute y sub j, or the rate of change of y sub j, I don't really care. Y sub j can do whatever it wants. It can have any pattern. That pattern is never going to influence the rest of the neurons. Conversely, as you said, evolution might turn up the gain of one particular important neuron and might be a stop neuron. Whenever that neuron is activated, it massively influences everybody else, right? Assuming those connections are non-zero. Okay. Evolution could increase the importance or the volume of a neuron by individually tuning up all of the outgoing synapses from J, but that would require a lot of mutations one after the other. So a gain kind of gives evolution a shortcut to turn up the global volume of one neuron or tune down the global volume of one neuron. So there's a little bit of redundancy here between W and G. Okay. Second last piece here. Let's add in a bias now. Theta sub J. What is the bias neuron doing? What is the bias value doing here? Again, we see that we have a theta sub J here. So each individual neuron has its own individual theta value. What does this do?
Makes the connections more complex.
That's true. That you're absolutely right. But let's work from the inside out first, right? Imagine that for a moment I delete everything. I delete all of this stuff, except I leave this in there and just the y sub j plus theta.
So it kind of biases it towards a certain result. Like
exactly.
If it's normally inhibitory and the bias is negative, it will make it even more so.
Exactly.
If it's being excitatory, then it'll bias it down, so it won't be as excitatory.
Exactly. So it's a bias that's just kind of moving the default value of the neuron. So if a particular neuron has a theta sub I of 0.5, then if the neuron is not influenced by everybody else, if all the weights are zero that are feeding into y sub I, instead of decaying to zero, it will decay towards its default value, right? So the gain increases the amplitude, so to speak, of the neuron, and the bias changes its offset. So if you have a positive bias, if at a given point in time no other neurons are bothering you, you will tend to approach your set point, right? Your bias value. So far, so good? Okay. Very final piece. Again, we're talking about artificial neural networks. We're talking them outside our robot body, but of course we're going to use these ctRNNs to get sensory information from the world and exert forces on the world. So when we create a ctRNN, let's say again we create a ctRNN with 10 neurons, we might tag a subset of those 10 neurons to be sensor neurons. So some of them are going to receive information, uppercase I, or input from the outside world. And all the other neurons that we didn't tag, this term is just zero. You're not receiving any information from the outside world. So if we have a differential equation here that is a sensor neuron, let's say we have one of these neurons which is receiving information from a touch sensor. A touch sensor says zero when that body part is not in contact with anything, and the touch sensor is one when that object is in contact with something. So at every time step, we would set this value just for that differential equation to 1 if it's in contact with something and 0 if it's not. So we're just supplying a number to this differential equation if it's a sensor neuron. So let's assume that this neuron is a sensor neuron. It's attached to the leg of a robot. That leg comes in contact with the ground. The touch sensor fires, and we set this value to 1 for this differential equation at that time step. What happens to y sub I? How does it start to change? How does it start to change continuously? All other things being equal. How does the rate of change, y prime here, change when the touch sensor fires? Go ahead.
Okay, well, if everything else is left equal, if it senses something and it's more than its current value, it will fire.
So what does it mean for y sub I to fire? So fire usually is a discrete descriptor, right? A touch sensor fires. It goes from 0 to 1 instantaneously or vice versa. But what happens to the input neuron that's receiving the value from that touch sensor? Imagine all this here is 0, and this is 0, and then this body part comes into contact with the ground. This changes from 0 to 1. How does y sub I respond to that instantaneous change? It starts to increase, right? Y sub I, all the neurons in a continuous time recurrent neural network change continuously over time. That's the CT, right? So there's a discrete change out there in the world reported by the touch sensor, but it has a continuous influence on this neuron. If suddenly, as the robot is moving, the leg comes off the ground and I sub I, not very good terminology there, I sub I suddenly goes to 0 because the body part comes off the ground, this will start to decrease. Or actually, I guess it will stay the same, right? If we're saying everything else is the same. If I sub I is 0 and everything else on the right-hand side is 0, this will stay constant. However, this, remember, is pulling it down because this is positive, so it'll start to come down, so on and so forth. Yes?
So, no, you just answered what I was going to ask.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
fair enough.
Sorry.
That's all right. Okay, so that's continuous time recurrent neural networks. It's a bit of a complicated equation. We have a whole bunch of them. I think probably this is a good place to stop. Best thing to do now is to study these slides and go back and go through this as we just did it and build up an intuition so you understand all the parts of this equation. Just to say this again, if you have a neural network made up of n neurons, then that C tier in n is described by n differential equations. Okay, you have a quiz due tonight. You can get started on assignment 5, and I will see you on Thursday. Thank you.
Really? Thank you.